Hi everybody, this is Dr. A, and we're going to do a quick review on the blood and the lymphatic system. Alright, so let's start with blood. Blood is composed of plasma, which is the liquid portion, and then cellular components that are called the formed elements. Plasma is composed of 90% water and then 10% dissolved proteins, amino acids, gases, electrolytes, sugars, hormones, lipids, and vitamins. The most significant element of plasma are the proteins, of which more than half are albumin, and then the rest are made of the immunoglobulins, which are the antibodies, and fibrinogen, which is involved in clotting. Serum is plasma without its clotting factors, and serum is formed when blood is collected in a glass or plastic tube, and it's induced to clot, and then it's spun down, and the liquid portion is serum. Serum does not have the fibrinogen and, you know, clotting factors. The conversion of fibrinogen to fibrin forms strands that trap all of the cellular elements in a clot. The formed elements comprise 45% of the blood volume, and of those, 99% are red cells, with white cells and platelets making up the rest, the other 1%. The red cells carry hemoglobin, which is the iron-containing oxygen transport protein that gives blood its red color. There are about 5 million red cells in a microliter of blood, and a single red cell remains in the peripheral circulation about 120 days before being removed by the liver, bone marrow, or spleen. White cells protect the body from infection. There are about 5,000 to 10,000 white cells in a microliter of whole blood. And at any time, most white cells are not in the blood, but in the peripheral tissues and the lymphatic system. White cell lifespan varies depending on the type of white cells, with neutrophils being the shortest lived. Their lifespan is counted in days, whereas lymphocytes are going to be your longest lived, with their lifespan counted in years. There are five types of white cells. So neutrophils, which are really good at fighting off bacteria, eosinophils, which are involved in fighting off parasites and then also involved in allergic reactions. Basophils are involved in allergic reactions, but more like the chronic hay fever type. The basophils can release histamine. Then your monocytes do a little bit of everything, and they become macrophages when they move into the tissue. And they're kind of like your security crew. They can deal with bacteria, they can deal with parasites, they can deal with viruses. And then your lymphocytes, they patrol the body, and they are involved with specific immunity. They make antibodies. They're really good for fighting off viruses, but they have a role in fighting off all the different pathogens. Platelets are created in the bone marrow from megakaryocytes, and platelets are actually cell fragments. They're little fragments of the cytoplasm of a megakaryocyte. Every 1 mL of blood contains about 200,000 platelets, each of which remains in circulation for 9 to 12 days. And but I think it is a microliter of blood like everything else. The microliter of blood for the 5 to 10,000 white cells, and for the 5 million red cells, I believe it's a microliter of blood for the 200,000 platelets, because that is what we count when we do a CBC, and those are all your average values for a CBC. This slide has a representation of all these formed elements. We have our pretty red cells here, the erythrocytes. Then we have our white cells. We have a neutrophil, an eosinophil, a monocyte, a lymphocyte, and a basophil. And then we have our platelets, which are cell fragments and involved in clotting and coagulation. So hemostasis, if you break it down, stasis is static, it's stop, and then hemo is blood, so blood stop, and so that's the process of clotting, and so that's also the process by which blood vessels are repaired after injury. There are four phases to hemostasis. The first phase is the vascular phase, so the rupture of a vein or artery will cause an immediate vascular spasm or contraction of the smooth muscle lining the vessel. This reduces the vessel diameter, and that substantially reduces the blood loss that would otherwise occur if the vascular spasm did not occur. Next is the platelet phase. So aggregating platelets will become activated by that damage, and they will start releasing factors that will start promoting fibrin accumulation in the next phase. So the combination of the vascular phase and the platelet phase with the platelets activating is called primary hemostasis. Next is the coagulation phase. So coagulation is a cascade of enzymes and factors that ultimately results in a blood clot. It is initiated by the release of tissue factor if it goes down the extrinsic pathway, or it can be initiated by other plasma coagulation factors that contact the materials that are exposed when the blood vessel is damaged, and that would be the intrinsic pathway, and then they both come together for the common pathway to form fibrin, and that should form a stable clot. The last phase is fibrinolysis, which is actually the removal or lysis degradation of the fibrin of the clot, and that would occur once the clot has done its job and the vessel has been repaired. That clot needs to be removed. And so fibrinolysis is controlled by plasmin, which is an enzyme made from plasminogen by a tissue plasminogen activator. It's also interesting to note that fibrin degradation products, FDPs, also sometimes referred to as D-dimers. A D-dimer is a fibrin degradation product. They are monitored to diagnose diseases like disseminated intravascular coagulation, which is a condition in which blood clots abnormally in the circulatory system. It plugs up the circulatory system and then uses up all the clotting factors, and then you have a bleeding problem. FDPs and D-dimers can also be used to screen for blood clots. They just won't tell you the location of the blood clot. They will just tell you that there are some degradation products that are present, meaning that there's a clot somewhere that's happened. And so they can be a useful screening tool. And then we have the lymphatic system. So the lymphatic system includes the lymphatic vessels, the capillaries and lymph ducts, and then the lymph nodes also, and then several organs, plus the lymph fluid that flows through the vessels. Some of those organs are like the spleen and the thymus. The lymphatic vessels are closed at their distal ends, so they're like dead-end tubes, unlike arteries and veins, which are a closed circuit that's interconnected. The lymphatic system returns fluid to the circulatory system, and in the process, it screens that fluid for signs of infection, and it also provides a passageway for the lymphocytes and monocytes that are patrolling these tissues. The lymphatic fluid is derived from the fluid between the cells, which is called the interstitial fluid. And so as the interstitial fluid accumulates between the cells, then it has to go somewhere. And if the fluid doesn't move into the cells, then it will move into the lymphatic capillaries and be returned to the venous circulation. The lymph nodes are chambers that are located along the lymphatic vessels. They're populated by lymphocytes. They are especially abundant in the digestive, respiratory, and urinary tracts. You also have them around your neck here, in your armpits, axillary, and in your groin area. And then a little bit on the immune system, you have nonspecific immunity. So that refers to the defense against infectious agents that is independent of the specific chemical markers on their surfaces. So it doesn't matter what they are, if they're bacteria, if they're virus, if they're a pathogen or whatever, that these defenses are in place. And so this would include physical barriers like an intact skin or intact mucous membranes, the complement system, and then other chemicals on and in the body. Phagocytes like white cells, most specifically monocytes and macrophages, and dendritic cells and stuff that are stationed all over the body, and they will engulf and destroy foreign cells without regard to their exact identity. So they're kind of our security patrol, like I said earlier. And then specific immunity involves recognizing antigens that are from pathogenic entities, bacteria or viruses. They're foreign to the body and they need to be reacted against. And so the recognition of these antigens as pathogens then triggers the activation of T cells and B cells. Your T cells do cellular immunity, so that's cell-to-cell immunity. So your T cells look for viral-infected cells and cancer cells and destroy those cells that are abnormal infected. And then your B cells create antibodies, and so that's humoral or antibody-based immunity, and antibodies can protect you against a variety of things, so viruses, you know, bacteria, and etc. So anyway, that's a quick overview of the blood and the lymphatic and immune system. Very, very short, very quick review. So thank you again for your attention.